Wait, there's something very weak coming through.
Ahsoka, I am so sorry about everything.
You have our most humble apologies, little Ahsoka. The Council was wrong to accuse you.
You have shown such great strength and resilience in your struggle to prove your innocence.
This is the true sign of a Jedi Knight.
This was actually your great trial. Now we see that. We understand that the Force works in mysterious ways. And because of this trial, you have become a greater Jedi than you would have otherwise.
Back into the Order, you may come.
They're asking you back, Ahsoka.
I'm asking you back.
Why are you doing this?
The Council didn't trust me. So how can I trust myself?
What about me? I believed in you. I stood by you.
I know you believe in me, Anakin. And I'm grateful for that. But this isn't about you. I can't stay here any longer. Not now.
The Jedi Order is your life. You can't just throw it away like this. Ahsoka, you are making a mistake.
Maybe. But I have to sort this out on my own. Without the Council. And without you.
I understand. More than you realize, I understand wanting to walk away from the Order.
I know.
A long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away.
Hello, fellow galactic listeners. I'm Todd Hoffman, and this is WSTR Galactic Public Access, a Star Wars podcast. Welcome to episode 140. Today, we're going to be doing an Imperial inspection on Ahsoka Tano with our very special guest, Michelle from Fulcrum's broadcast. Welcome to the show, Michelle.
Hi, thank you for having me.
We're so excited for you to join. Can't wait to dive into a little bit of Ahsoka today. And then joining me today, as always, Miss Heather Allred.
We got another lady in the house. It's not just me.
Hey.
And yes, Mr. Aaron Julian has the day off, so I am outnumbered here. So that's okay. It's all good.
It's going to be fine.
Yeah, I know. It's going to be fine. It's going to be all fine. All right. Stick with us. We got to pay some bills. So it ain't easy living with the price on your head. So you can find everyone here on social media at WSTR Media, all one word, all lowercase. Email us at mailbox@wstrmedia.com. You can leave us a voicemail at 630-557-WSTR. That's 630-557-9787. Operators are staring by. We want to hear from you, and we want to hear your gorgeous voice blasted across the galactic holonet. you can definitely do that by leaving us a voicemail. Hey, we got a whole back catalog of episodes, actually 139 of them, and maybe a couple bonus ones. All the links can be found at podcast.wstrmedia.com. Hey, you should check out Audible. It's an easy, no-risk way to support this podcast. Find entertainment, education, and Aaron has found out that it's edumentation, or I don't know. Enter. He said there's word that he made up, I think, but he said he's
entertainment and education.
Yeah, but he put them together.
I know.
It's edumentation or something. I don't know. Anyways, you can learn, or you can be, you know, just you want to waste some time on Audible. You can do that. That's Amazon's Audible book service, which brings you over 425,000 titles. That is like a legitimate lot of choices to choose from. If you head over to audibletrial.com/WSTR, get your free 30-day trial, includes a free Audible book of your choice, and then two Audible originals. And every month they release new exclusives, and you can check them out. And obviously, if you could choose two of those and then over 425,000 titles, it's a win-win. So support our podcast by heading over to audibletrial.com/WSTR. We got merch, store.wstrmedia.com. Just go there, and we got all kinds of stuff. Socks, hoodies, t-shirts, hats, leggings. I don't know. There's a lot there. So you can go there and check out all this stuff. Heather, tease that news.
Sir. This is my favorite part. All right. I have four items for you. Number one. Okay. Mostly images, really.
Okay.
Which will be hard to do on a podcast. We'll see how it goes. Number two.
Yeah.
Jurassic World.
Okay.
Number three. Snoke ain't no joke.
It might be about Snoke.
It might be about Snoke. My upcoming rap career. We'll see how
it goes. Oh my God, yes.
And then number four.
I didn't know you were going to drop an album.
I'll save that for Cantina Chat, people. Right. and for Price of Evil.
Whoa.
Dun, dun, dun.
Yeah, I know. That's like a lot.
It's kind of heavy.
Yeah, it is heavy. All right, well, we're going to have to wait till the news section to find out more.
True story.
All right. Shall we move on to Twitter Trash Compactor?
Yes, please.
Get in there, you big toy! I don't care what you smell. Get in there. Don't worry about it.
Okay. Every week, we're running those polls. This one was kind of important, Heather.
It was, yes.
Yeah. So, Heather, you know, this happened to go Galaxy's Edge. No big deal. Not only did you buy one droid, you bought two droids. So you bought the Astromech droid, right?
Yes, I got an R unit, so similar to R2-D2.
Yeah.
His name is Alan.
And that's from what's the meaning behind that one?
Yeah. So his full name is R6-AL.
Right.
When my brother passed, and okay. I got, you know, head deep into the Star Wars world, I always knew that I wanted a droid, and I wanted to dedicate it to my brother. So
I built
Alan. So if you've been on WSTR Media socials, you would have seen him. He's my red droid. So R6 is the month of his birth, and AL is not only the first two letters of his middle name, Alan, it's also the first two letters of his last name, Allred.
Oh my gosh. He happens
to be an all-red droid.
Aww.
Get it?
Dude, that's like triple, that's like Inception deep right there.
It's like Inception.
It's like several layers in there.
So
well, that's awesome.
So R6-AL, I call him Alan.
I love it. That's amazing. Well, but you had some difficulty with the BB-8 droid, or the BB droid. So here was our question. Help, you are our only hope. What should Heather name her BB droid? Comments welcome for fan choice. So, because you were struggling, I'm like, hey, let's throw it to social media. Let's just do it. So we have three choices, or four choices. BBH, BBO, as AKA Bo,
BB0.
Oh, BB0.
Sorry.
At AKA Bo. And then OB1, or fan choice.
That's cute.
Seriously, this was close. This was like really tight. So BBH, 9%, but OB1, and fan choice, 27%. But 36% says BB0, AKA Bo.
Okay.
It has been blessed by the social medias.
So, can I explain the reason behind why I put BB0 out there?
Please, yes.
Right. So, my BB unit is a orange and white main base with then a little black head. Mm-hmm. And when I first saw him, he just looked like that dog in the pound that nobody wanted to adopt because he was kind of scruffy. Mm. He was just this little droid that got put together with other people's parts from leftover, and mm-hmm. So I adopted him into my family, and I thought BB0 being like an unregistered BB unit versus like BB-8 or BB-9E on the Empire, and so I thought BB0 would be a great unregistered name, but similar to how Finn gets named in Force Awakens by putting his trooper number together, I thought BB0 yeah. looked like Bo, so I would name him Bo.
Oh my gosh.
That's I am adorable. So glad the Twitterverse agreed.
Yeah, because you're like, I might have just chosen that already, but you know. Awesome.
That's my
Well, that's another deep cut. I like it.
I spend too much time thinking about droids.
There's nothing wrong with that.
It's my life.
Michelle, do you have any favorite droids?
I am a huge sucker for BB-8. Like, anytime BB-8 makes a noise, I think it's the cutest thing in the world. I really do. But obviously, you got the classics, R2 and 3PO. Just the droid duo that I love the best. And then Chopper from Rebels is really awesome, too. So...
true story.
Chopper's like a cat.
Right.
He's like,
yeah.
He just has his own like thing going on, and yeah, there's a couple Chopper moments I just love. I'm just like, yeah.
Yeah, he is quite the character, and I think that's what is so awesome about a lot of the droids that are in Star Wars is they're droids, but the creators put so much life and personality into each and every one of them. So, you know, Chopper's mischievous and he knows it and he like brags about it. So it's great.
Yeah, it's awesome. Yeah, I'm kind of sucker for K2.
I love K2.
If I had to choose my favorite, it might be him. But yeah, they're all good. They all have their own quirks, but Heather kind of has like, she loves all droids. She's our droid lover.
It's true.
If you're a
droid or a furry
you're
Ewok,
right.
Got you covered.
Right.
People,
not furry.
I was just going to end there. I was like, oh.
We're not going to say, it's not furries. It's furry creatures. You have to be very specific here. Because furries is a whole nother cosplay and other things.
True story. That. My bad.
Right. We have to be very careful here. But yeah. Furry creatures in Star Wars.
Within Star Wars. Go. Yes. Good.
Yes.
Let's just keep narrowing that down.
Droids in Star Wars and then furry creatures in Star Wars. There you go. So. So there you have it. Since Aaron's not here, we don't have any spicy tweets or any hot takes in Twitterverse. So there you go. So every week we run a poll. Thank you for voting. That was mission critical right there. So thank you for voting. Heather's happy. So that's good. That's good. So Every week, you know, check it out. We're running old Twitter polls, and one of these days they will get more than four options, and then we can have like 10, and it'll be great. So, but I think it's already time. Let's move on to our main topic.
What?
And now for our feature presentation.
All right, Michelle, since you are our special guest, you are in the hot seat. So
fantastic.
Why don't we start with a very easy question?
Okay.
And maybe it's long-winded, maybe it's like 2 seconds, but how did you get into Star Wars?
Well, this will probably be a long-winded answer because I really like to talk. So I had watched the original trilogy when I was younger, and when I was growing up, the prequel movies were coming out. I was pretty young, so I don't remember seeing all of them in the theaters, with the exception of Revenge of the Sith. I do remember seeing that in the theaters. But I knew about the movies, and my brother was a little bit more into them. But what really got me like super into Star Wars would be the Clone Wars. The animated show and the characters. And I think I really started diving into like fandom when the 5th season of the Clone Wars was about to air, and I kept seeing like TV previews for it, and I was like, oh my gosh, I used to watch this show. But there was a period of time where I just wasn't watching any TV when I was younger, so I had forgotten about it. And then when there were these trailers, you know, I don't know if you remembered the season 5 trailer or not, if you watched it, but it was like mind-blowing. Sidious was in it, like showing up for the first time, and then you see him battling Maul and Obi-Wan and Maul and all this stuff. So it was very intense, and then I was just like awed by it. So I think probably the Clone Wars and that, seeing that trailer everywhere, really got me into it.
All right,
that's my long answer.
That was not very long at all. So you got into your entry point is basically Clone Wars. Mm-hmm. And now if you're into podcasting, how did that happen? Tell us what happened there.
Oh my gosh. Well, a couple of years ago, I realized that there was a pocket of Star Wars like fandom that I wasn't into yet, and that was podcasting. And so I started looking into it. But ultimately, the reason why I started my own is because I wasn't seeing what I wanted to listen to, and specifically that being like a 30-minute show. I am a very busy student, like running around constantly, like commuting and doing and studying. And then I'm at this club organization group and all this stuff. So I was running around and not having enough time to sit down and listen to an hour podcast. And I'm somebody that likes to listen to things most of the way through. Like, I don't like to stop a show and then have to come back to it, because then I feel like I'll forget what happened. So I remember being like, one day I want to create a 30-minute podcast that I am just going to have fun with and just let loose a little bit. Like, I wasn't really gonna, you know, be like, I have to be this certain way. I was just gonna be my normal self. And so that's how I guess I personally got into podcasting. But there are so many wonderful Star Wars podcasts that I've started listening to, and like yours, and my other favorite is Castle Run Weekly, which I know you know them very well.
We know Danny. Yeah.
So it's been a lot of fun.
Cool. Yeah, Danny's great. I personally just stalked him, and now we're friends. So that's great.
That's awesome. Yep.
Stalker to friendship. Nothing awkward there.
It was a very healthy online relationship. Yeah. Yeah, no, I like, seriously, he was posting a bunch of stuff. I like, because I kind of go in this FOMO stage when like it was like a celebration, and it was celebration 2017. I couldn't go. Mm-hmm. So I just put on my Instagram and, you know, like anything that hit celebration or, you know. And so Danny kept on popping up, and I was like, oh, this dude looks cool. Started liking his stuff. And then I'm like, oh, he has a podcast. Mm-hmm. And then I just stalked him, and now we're friends, and we got to meet in Celebration Chicago. So it was cool. It's cool.
That's
so
awesome. Oh yeah. I love Danny. I think Kessel Run Weekly was one of the first podcasts that I like started interacting with. And for me, I'm primarily based on Instagram for a lot of like absorbing Star Wars content. So
sure.
It was the first, like, I think Danny does a really good job of blending like Star Wars fandom in like, hey, here's a news piece that came out, but then also being like, hey, by the way, like we have this show and we stream us playing Battlefront. And I just think he does a really wonderful job with that. So that's how I got connected with him too, was through that way.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Very cool.
That's great. Well, hey, we're a big family, so any Star Wars is good Star Wars in my book. So, all right, I think it's time to do some Imperial inspection on Ahsoka Tano. So here's a 2-minute version of Ahsoka, and we're going to really dive into it. But basically, Ahsoka Tano is from the planet Shili, if you didn't know that, and she's a Toruga? How do you say it?
I've always Toruga? Said Togruda.
Toruga? Yeah.
Yeah.
If we're Chicago, it's like Togruta.
Oh my God. I know. I'm so, like, Togruta?
Togruta?
But don't ask me to say your name either. So really.
Yeah, right. So our good friend, Master Plo Koon, which I love Mr. Jedi Master Plo Koon, brought her to the Jedi Temple, because that's okay. When you're light side, it's okay to abduct babies in a very spiritual kind of way. And so that's how Ahsoka got to the Jedi Temple. Another species that's famous is Shakti, she's from Attack of the Clones, and she's the same species as Ahsoka. And there is a youngling in Yoda's Bear Clan, and also in Attack of the Clones, that you can see that's a Togruta or Togruta or however you want to say that. We meet her in the Clone Wars movie, which just celebrated, I think, 11 years.
Yeah. Crazy. Yeah.
So, you know, it's a great plot. She's saving Stinky or Rota, the son of Jabba the Hutt. And that's where we meet Clone Wars, or in Clone Wars with Ahsoka. She's really grown up. You know, she was called Snips, and Sky Guy and Snips, and people didn't really like her, and she was annoying. But at the end here, she's framed for a bombing at the Jedi Temple. She kind of escapes into the Coruscant underworld, partners with an unlikely ally of Azaj Ventress, and turns out, it was another Padawan, Barriss Offee, and she could also be seen in Attack of Clones and obviously Clone Wars and stuff like that. And then, probably the saddest part of Clone Wars is at the end, she leaves not only Anakin, but then she leaves the Jedi Order, because she ain't putting up with that stuff. What do you think about so far with that, Michelle? What do you like about Ahsoka?
Oh my gosh. Well, I want to mention that I was actually one of those people that didn't like her at first. I really did find her annoying. And in a weird way, it was like this love-hate relationship with her, because I adored her. I always found the Jedi really fascinating. Again, growing up with the prequel movies, they were so focused on like the Jedi lore and seeing Anakin and Obi-Wan. I was always like, oh my God, the Jedi are so cool. So to have this young woman wielding a lightsaber, you know, the forefront of this show was really, really exciting. But I did find her very annoying, and she had a lot of growing up to do. So I think one of the coolest things about her is that we get to see her over the course of the entire Clone Wars show. And then even in Rebels too, she becomes this wonderful leader, and she really matures, and I think she becomes like a mentor. I know Ashley Eckstein, the voice actress, talks about this too, but she really does become like a Yoda type mentor to some of the characters in Rebels, and
interesting.
So I think that's pretty cool.
Well, and you know, she's coming in, I think her age is about 14 when she appears in the Clone Wars movie. So, of course she's going to be annoying.
Right. Most 14-year-olds are annoying.
Right? Yes. I mean, most 14-year-olds are like into boy bands and, you know, those kind of things. But from a, she, you know, the thing, I think honestly, up front, is she goes toe-to-toe with Anakin, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. which I think at that point, Anakin and Obi-Wan almost in the Clone Wars, they have more of a brother relationship than a mentor, like a Padawan Jedi relationship. Their relationship is unique, as well as kind of Anakin's and Ahsoka's. Mm-hmm. So, but I feel like Ahsoka really didn't put up with, because Anakin kind of comes off as a rock star in a sense, you know, like, hey.
Yeah. And she met that level of like sassiness and energy. And so that their dynamic was different in like a good way. But like you were saying, Obi-Wan and Anakin's was good as well, but it was just a different type of relationship. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's kind of where, for a while there, that's at the end of season five, in mm-hmm. a sense, that's, you know, not only the end of Clone Wars, the actual series, but Ahsoka's arc is kind of ended there. We pick up, there is some more, obviously, with the Lost episodes, there is some more with Ahsoka, which is great. But then in the book, the Ahsoka Tano book, she's kind of on her own, in hiding, in a sense, gets involved with some locals at this planet, helps her out. There's, what are they called? The Inquisitors that come, and she basically kills an Inquisitor, takes his lightsaber, and changes it from blood red to white.
Yeah, she purifies the crystals.
Yes, through the Force, which I think is also kind of interesting, because it's almost like she's not colorless. It's like colorless mm-hmm. in a sense, because it's, which is interesting. And through that, she meets Bail Organa, because Bail's on the DL with some rebel activity. So you have that kind of relationship, and that's what forms. She wants to do good, but she also doesn't think that the Jedi are all that and a bag of chips. And so she basically has this alias with Bail, and says, I'll do this code name and provide intelligence and rebel factions, and that is Fulcrum.
Yeah.
So what do you think about that?
I think that's epic.
well, your podcast is named...
Yeah, I'm a little biased.
Yeah, a little biased.
No, she's an awesome rebel leader, and I think that part of the book was really cool, seeing how she meets Bail and is like, okay, yeah, I'm going to do this. I do think your point, too, about her kind of purifying the crystal and not being like... the typical, like, her lightsaber isn't the typical Jedi colors, and it's not red anymore either. I think that just shows that she's a Force user, right? Like, she even says in Rebels, when she's about to fight Vader, like, I am no Jedi. And I really think she is a good example of just kind of like the Force wielders from the Mortis episodes. And then they were also highlighted in Rebels too, the father, son, and daughter. They are just Force wielders. They know how to use the Force. There is a light side and a dark side, and then the Force is the balance. But I think Ahsoka is somebody that maybe she doesn't practice the Jedi teachings anymore, that she's still a light side Force user. That makes sense. So I always thought that was really cool. Kind of an introduction into that lore.
Do you think she's light or is she gray?
I think she's light. Mm-hmm. Because she does a lot of good things, and I don't think you can be gray. Unless you were truly like the beings, like the Mortis, like the father.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because even the Force wielders, you know, the daughter was the light side and the son was the dark side. And the father was kind of, you know, trying to control them, trying to balance everything out. But ultimately, I don't know. I don't know that you can really be in the middle, because she does end up helping the Alliance, the Rebel Alliance. So that's a light side thing, at least to me.
Yeah. Heather, what say you, Heather?
Yeah.
I find this all very fascinating. So Michelle, here's the scoop.
Ooh.
I have seen like half of the first season of The Clone Wars.
Okay.
And that's it.
Listen, that's okay, because you have plenty of time to watch it until when the next season comes out.
I appreciate that attitude, yeah, that I am not being held accountable having seen it all already.
There's so much Star Wars to absorb. No judgment here from me at all.
Listen, I'm a grown adult with a full-time job, people. Right. There's only so much I can get done.
Right.
Right.
So, right.
And you have two boys that like push you into watching more Star Wars, so, you know.
I don't know, they made me watch this Christmas special, and from there it was just downhill. But seriously, so I don't know a lot from the show and what have you, but, you know, Michelle, I'm all over the socials and the Instagram, and, you know, Pinterest is a black hole of things. And
yeah.
So you kind of naturally see a lot in certain things. So I wouldn't call them spoilers so much as mini previews of things that I need to be made aware of, kind of a thing. So, you know, I've learned a lot just in our little 2-minute recap here, if you will. Super fascinated by this whole cleansing the crystal thing. Mm-hmm. So we're going to need to read books and figure that whole thing out.
Hey, you could go to audibletrial.com/WSTR and you can get your free Audible book. And I think the coolest thing about the Audible book for Ahsoka is Ashley Eckstein reads the book.
Yes.
So it's
that changes everything.
It kind of sells it. I mean, that one in particular really, I mean, she is the voice of Ahsoka. You associate with Ahsoka with her, and the fact that she is reading that, it makes it that much better. So.
Totally. So, so that's super cool. I think I like, Michelle, your thought on the Grey Jedi thing, which almost makes me think, I wonder if that's true. Because we've had, you know, talks about, is Rey going to become a Grey Jedi in the sequel trilogy and things like that? And are we ever going to see a Grey Jedi in the Skywalker situation? But, you know, and I knew nothing about Fulcrum, so that was intriguing to know as well. Listen, people, I've got a lot to learn, but I guess I'd be intrigued to see her as a middle ground. From, you know, our apparently religious stealing of children, being forced into this thing, kind of having a sass that that we've seen, staying with the rebels, but then having these moments, I guess, where she maybe plays by the rules a little differently or twists them to get something accomplished, that may not 100% fall in to the Jedi line of this is how we get things done. Especially with renaming herself for doing these other things that, sorry, everybody. But I wonder if that's part of what the Grey Order is, not knowing everything about the Grey Jedi and how balance of the Force and everything. So that would be a really intriguing way to go if they did. Yeah. But I totally hear what you're saying as well.
Well, there's a part of her story that we don't know yet either.
Yeah,
right.
Post Return of the Jedi. So there's a whole opportunity for them to explore exactly what you're talking about. What is she learning about the Force that maybe does place her in a more neutral ground? You know, maybe she's learning from the Sith Temple like Ezra did at one point in Rebels. So I would love to see that. I think that'd be really interesting.
Yeah, I'm going to kind of counter that. I'm going to take you to church here. I think Ahsoka is a Jedi without religion. So what happened in Clone Wars is that the Jedi are, you know, we see this in the prequel trilogy and in Clone Wars, that the Jedi have kind of lost their way. And I've said this before in the podcast, putting the Jedi temple in Coruscant is like the Pope taking the Catholic Church and putting it in Las Vegas. That's basically what Yoda did. He took the temple, a holy thing that a Jedi is supposed to be doing, purity, all this kind of stuff, blah, 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 and puts it in Las Vegas. And that's what Coruscant is. So that's Yoda. I'm not going to talk about Yoda, but I feel like clearly the Jedi failed, and there's a parallel between her and Anakin, which is not really talked about a lot, is that she is disappointed in the council and what they decided to do with it, and with her situation, and Anakin gets slighted by the council, basically saying, you know, you can sit in the council, but you're not a master. Take your seat, you know.
And sorry, Anakin's I'm laughing because it's like it's just a meme thing, you know. Oh my god.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
No, it's fine.
Take
it's
a fine. Seat, young Skywalker.
It's like base. Like all right, whatever. But I really feel, you know, at that point when she's like, I gotta get out of here. She can see the writing on the wall as far as the corruption that is happening. Not that. Or it's really not corruption. It's more or less blindness to what's happening in the Republic with the Chancellor, with everything, with, you know, the Republic and the kind of Republic army and all that jazz. Like, she kind of sees it and it's like, yeah, we're not supposed to be like this.
Yeah.
And so, in a sense, the Jedi represents religion in a sense, like making rules around how to use the Force. Mm. And she's like, I got to get out of here. Mm. This is not me, but I'm still going to do the right thing. So she's kind of like, she has her path. Because again, at the end of the day, the Force is not evil or good.
Right.
It's just the Force and how you use it. And so, you kind of get that feeling in the book as far as like, she can't help not to help people. Like, that's her deal. Like, she's got to help the weak. She's got to help, you know, the people that are less fortunate, and she wants to do right. The fortunate part is like once you live, you know, light a lightsaber, oh, you're a Jedi. And right now you can't really be a Jedi in the current state of affairs after Order 66 and all that fun stuff. So she just, that's why she kind of does this Fulcrum thing where it's like, I can provide intelligence and still do good, but I'm not bound by being a Jedi. But I'm still doing good in the universe in this little, and I'm doing the best I can with the circumstances around me. And I think that's where kind of Ahsoka lies.
Yeah.
And like the gray Jedi technically is like using both the dark and the light
together. Okay, I didn't
together.
Know that. That's interesting. I don't really know anything about the gray Jedi.
I mean, the other one that you can lean on too is the Bendu
from Rebels. Oh, I love Bendu.
Bendu is another. I think that's where you could kind of say Bendu and even Ahsoka kind of fall in that kind of line. Mm. So, pushing a little forward after Rebels. So, Darth Vader, you know, they're at the Sith Temple. Darth Vader does the most metal thing in the world and is standing on top of his TIE fighter and coming down with his lightsaber. And you're just like, dude, this is so metal. This is amazing. And Ahsoka, they have a fight and Ahsoka gets a little bit of Darth Vader and she kind of finds out that he's Anakin Skywalker. What do you think about this fight? This fight is like pretty amazing.
It's gorgeous. I have watched it so many times.
It's so good.
Yeah. It's, and especially their dialogue before they actually start fighting. It's just so emotional. And so it carries, and the score behind it too is like the music is reflective of the music from the Clone Wars. So the whole build up to that fight, the entire season of Rebels, was beautiful. It was, I could just go on about it, but the fight was beautiful. Really well done. And I just think like there was so much leading up to it and so much their relationship was one of the focal points of the Clone Wars. So to have them not even in the Clone Wars, but in Rebels to, you know, have this type of like moment, I think was very special for all of Star Wars to kind of have in it now.
Yeah. 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 And then she basically has this fight in the temple. There's a lot of things going on. Temple kind of collapses, and that's it. We don't know what happened. But later in the Rebels, probably one of the most significant episodes, yes. World Between Worlds, Ezra is in, I don't know.
Well, world between worlds.
he's on Rainbow Bridge. He's kind of looking through these things, can hear all these voices, and he sees I lack of a better word, an owl in a sense.
She's a carnivore.
Apparently. Thank you. You're welcome.
Yes. That was one of my podcast episodes that I talked about this owl. So yeah.
Like this owl, and he sees the fight happening between Anakin, Darth Vader, and Ahsoka. He's like, dude, I was there. And literally pulls her out right before Anakin goes for the kill, and she's saved. But then she decides, well, you know, there's a lot of things. We don't want to spoil it too much for Heather. This thing's happened. And she goes back. She goes back into her time frame, mm-hmm. in back to the temple, but she's saved in a sense. So basically, at the end of Rebels, she shows up like, so this is like literally the biggest question is like, mm-hmm. how do we get from Snips to like Gandalf the White at the end of, this is kind of her story arc, you know, right. We get this annoying teenager to this wise wizard at the end.
Right.
So what do you think about that there, Michelle?
I think she's had a lot of experiences in her life, both good and mm-hmm. bad, that have, you know, helped her become the person that she is. And there's a huge chunk of time in between when she goes back to, you know, when they're in the World Between Worlds and then she goes back to her own timeline. There's a huge chunk of time between then and then when she shows up at the end of Rebels. Because, you know, then we have technically the third and the fourth season of Rebels that occur, like, timeline-wise. So I don't know how she becomes Gandalf or Ahsoka the White.
Pretty much, yeah.
We don't know, and I would love to find out. Because, I mean, she looks like a boss when she shows up. I started, like, yelling. I was watching the finale, and, you know, well, I want to say, too, so, I'm... Like, there's some stuff that happens in the finale. And so I'm already, like, off the couch, like, yelling at my TV screen, like, oh, my God. And then she shows up, and then, like, the tears came. So it was a wild journey. But, yeah, I just think that she's had so much thrown at her, and that the time period of, you know, she's been through the Clone Wars and then the fall of the Jedi and the Republic and then... If she's around at the end of Return of the Jedi, then she's been through, you know, the Galactic Civil War as well. So quite the experiences this Jedi has had.
Heather was patiently waving or raising her hand. So Heather, you have the floor.
I have a question for the audience here.
Right.
So this whole Gandalf the White situation.
Yes. Yeah.
Again, not knowing everything.
Sure, yeah, yeah.
Having the internet at my disposal.
Right.
Is this where she's like in her like winter outfit?
Yes.
Okay.
See, she has
really amazing.
Yeah, it's where she's got the staff. Please.
The staff, yeah. Yes, and the thing, and she's got the hood over the thing, and then...
We don't really know anything except that she's wearing like this big white cloak and she's got the little staff thing. Yeah, yeah.
She looks great.
I know. Ugh.
Yeah,
she's so intriguing.
Yeah, she basically has like the Staff of Ra from like Indiana Jones. Like boom. Yeah, I think you nailed it, Michelle. I think it's just her experiences and where she's at both mentally, spiritually, physically, that's where she's at, you know. And I think there is some serious maturity in that. And yeah, we don't know. I mean, technically her and Sabine go off to find Ezra and Thrawn in a sense in the unknown regions or wherever they're at. And so, yeah, it's kind of interesting. It's very interesting. And in fact, what can we learn from Ahsoka? What's the biggest takeaway from Ahsoka?
Oh my gosh. I always think of following your heart. Because like you were saying, her biggest story arc is when she gets framed, and then ultimately they offer her a position to come back into the Jedi Order. But she says no, because like you were saying, she can't trust them. They're not listening to the cries of the people, and also like one of their own was frustrated enough with the Jedi that she turned against them. So
exactly. Barissa's kind of position is kind of like, guys, you're not missing it. You know, she kind of went in a bad way. She framed her friend, you know, it's kind of, she lost her way too. But what she is trying to say is exactly what Ahsoka's like, dude, I don't want this.
I don't know if you've ever seen it, but there's a moment. Well, I know, Heather, you probably haven't since you haven't watched all the episodes, but there, if you find it, at once you watch the whole thing all the way through, there is a like alternate version of the ending of the Clone Wars when Anakin says, hey, like, come back. And I think she says something like, no, like, I can't or whatever. But the alternate take that Ashley and Matt recorded is where Ahsoka says, they should have never told me to leave. And it had so much more weight to it than what the actual take is. But ultimately, I think that the whole thing was done very beautifully, like that episode. But the fact that, you know, they had her almost like her character almost say, like, they should have never told me to leave because she feels betrayed by them. Anyway, I just think that was very like emotional. But ultimately, I think the biggest takeaway from her is to, at least from the Clone Wars, is to follow your heart, whether that is leaving something that you've known your entire life to go figure things out, or to go against what the rules say and break the rules a little bit. Or there's so many ways you can interpret the follow your heart thing, but I do think that holds true for a lot of things in life. So I would say that.
Interesting. Yeah. Okay. Where do you want to see Ahsoka at?
I don't know if this is... Well, I mean, I would love to see her in a comic. I know maybe that's not what you're asking, but I would love to see her in some sort of a comic. Maybe her adventures with Sabine, finding Ezra. Actually, I know I want that in whatever format, whether it's a comic, a show, a movie, whatever. But I also do think it would be interesting to learn about how she becomes Ahsoka the White, though I will say some things I do like that are left a mystery. There are certain things that's like, okay, we don't need to know everything. It kind of adds to the mystery of the, like, certain things, especially about the Force, I kind of like when we don't know everything about it, because the Force is the Force, right? Like, it's, for as long as Star Wars has been around, it's been this mysterious thing that no one can ever really fully understand or fully explain. It's always more of a feeling, or it's a, you know, it's this energy field that flows through all things, or whatever the quote is, right? But, yeah, so
binds us.
The galaxy together.
The tree, right. So, the tree, the rock.
Right. So I don't know. I think I would like to see some of her story played out, but also not all of it, you know, kind of just leave some room in there.
Yeah, I think I understand, like, comic. I'm saying, you know, would you want to see her live action?
Hell yeah. Oh, sorry. Yes, I really would. No, that'd be so cool. Yeah.
Rise of Skywalker.
I was going to say, Todd, do you think she's going to show up somewhere in one of the new Disney
things? Yeah, I mean, she's huge, man. She's huge.
That would be amazing.
Yeah, what happens?
Hang in there, Michelle. Yeah,
what happens if she shows up as like a Jedi spirit in The Rise of Skywalker?
I would probably start crying. Actually, I already know I'm going to cry in the theater, but I would start crying earlier than I expected. No.
Yeah, yeah.
No, right. I think I would lose my marbles. Like, that would be really cool. Yeah.
I mean, again, she's not following the same path as the Jedi, but there's definitely her wisdom and ability as we know it. Mm-hmm. She's definitely, you know, especially when she picks up Sabine, you're like, dude, I know you're at like another, she's at master level in a sense when she's with Sabine. So you're like, okay, she knows something. Mm-hmm. And I'm just saying, you know, either, again, there's a whole lot of time from now until you know, obviously Rise of Skywalker. Yeah. So I don't think she's going to be alive per se, mm-hmm. but I mean, what better way to do not only kind of like a tip of the hat, but also it would make sense if she was there, mm-hmm. you know, if we're going to go, you know, Jedi versus Sith or something like that, that she's present in that sense.
Yeah.
So
I also thought about her potentially being in The Mandalorian. However, I know that they're trying to steer away from the Force lore and the Jedi and everything. But depending on where the show goes, or also, oh, wait, I have a better idea. Sorry. Okay. The Cassian show, right? Cassian mm-hmm. is one of, oh my God. Okay. I don't know if you know this. Cassian is a Fulcrum agent. Like, he gets the label of Fulcrum as well. So anyway, okay, so she could appear there if she's passing the baton over to him, or...
Right, right.
Maybe they are entering the Rebel Alliance at the same time, and so they both get the codename Fulcrum. Because she... Ahsoka wasn't Ahsoka for the majority of season one of Rebels, right? Like, we only knew her as, like, ooh, this mysterious Fulcrum agent. Like, that could have been anybody. Yeah. So,
Yeah, I mean, the other thing, she has ties to Bail. We know she has ties to Bail. So that the Cassian angle might actually work.
Yeah. Oh, I would love that. That'd be really cool.
Obviously, you're excited for season 7. So what do you want to see? What do you want to see from Ahsoka? Because, again, now we're jumping back, because mm-hmm. that's what Star Wars does. We're jumping back to... after she left the Jedi Order, mm-hmm. and now there's something going on with the Mandalorians, mm-hmm. and she's helping them out. So what do you want to see from season 7 in February?
I cannot wait for her duel with Maul. Like, I'm beyond excited about it. They've already teased snippets of it in the trailer, or like that still that came out recently. But also, like, Maul is being mo-capped by Ray Park. Like, that's how they got the fight to happen. Anyway, it's going to be beautiful.
Layers, people. There's layers.
It's going to be awesome. And I think the other thing in season 7 is it's wrapping up the entire Clone Wars show. So it is almost putting a nice little bow on Ahsoka's relationship with Anakin, too. Like, on good terms before he obviously turns into Darth Vader and everything. So I know that there are going to be emotional, beautiful scenes when they reunite, and then when he's giving half the 501st to her. And so it's going to be very, very emotional and wonderful. Yeah.
Okay. There you go. Yeah. All right. So as we close this out, Heather, what say you about Ahsoka? Any last words, any thoughts, concerns, questions?
Yeah.
I have no concerns.
Okay.
Other than the fact that I haven't seen anything. But I think here's what I will say about it. And I love that despite the initial backlash of the character, that she stayed and became a beloved character. I love, if we're going with this age 14-year-old bracket of starting and then growing into an adult character, isn't that kind of what a Star Wars fan is? Is they're young and then they grow with the universe. And then we become mature as a fan. And when I say mature, I just mean older with more money to spend on kids' toys. But
merchandising.
I think that's a really cool feature about her character. It was interesting because Bruce told me about her being kind of annoying and then becoming beloved. So when I watched the beginning part of it, I was prepared for this really annoying character. And I'm like, she's not that annoying. She's just young and peppy.
Yeah.
Like, that's just how she is. Right. So it's kind of an interesting take for my introduction of her. So with what you guys have shared with me tonight, you know, and what I've read of Ashley and her personal journey with the character. I love seeing people surround a character that might not be part of our general public knowledge.
Yeah.
You know, she's not Leia. It's not Rey. It's, you know, it's one you've got to kind of dig to find, I guess.
Yeah, she's definitely a second level character in a sense, you know.
But to have the strong fandom that she has, that has to speak to her character, whether you know the details of it or not.
Right.
So I think that's huge. I guess that's kind of my reaction to this. So I look forward to getting back on my couch and doing nothing and just binging. Come on, winter months in Chicago.
Right.
I don't want to leave your house. I guess I'm excited to see kind of where her story ends. And you know, you gotta love a good bookend.
Yeah.
Of a character.
Yeah. Yeah. Michelle, you have anything else to add that we haven't said about Ahsoka?
Oh gosh. I don't know. I guess I'll just hit on Heather's point. This character definitely means so much to so many people because of her growth and all of that. And I once thought that, like, in a weird way, I also, like, was growing up with Ahsoka at certain parts. When she left the Jedi Order, I was, like, in my first year of high school, like, entering this whole new realm of things and all that. So I definitely feel like I have gone on a journey with her, with that character. That's probably why she's so special to me, too. So I definitely love that. I agree. There is such a strong... For the most part, there's such a strong love of this character. For not being in the movies, she is one of the main characters that I'll be like, hey, are you, like, when I ask people, oh, you're a Star Wars fan, are you into the shows, you know Ahsoka? Like, I will, hopefully not in, like, an annoying way or, like, whenever people say that they are fans, I always want to know if they watch the animated shows. And if they do, I immediately ask them about her, which, again, I'm a little biased, but hey, what can I say? Yeah. But, so I love all your points, Heather.
Thanks.
You're like, hey... Do you know about Ahsoka Tano? Let me tell you.
Yeah. Me knocking on everyone's door. Hey, have you heard of Ahsoka Tano? Yeah.
Right, exactly. You must, you know. Yeah, I know. I think she's definitely a great character and a great story in the Star Wars lore. Mm-hmm. And you definitely kind of hit it on the head as far as, like, again, your entry point is Clone Wars, and she was kind of growing through this growth thing. And I think that's why she resonates with a lot of people, and especially women, as far as just like, hey, you know, I'm going through this. I'm trying to figure things out. And I got all these people telling me different things. And like you said earlier, Michelle, it's like you got to follow your heart sometimes instead of what people are trying to tell you to do, you know? And I think that's very powerful. And again, I think... You know, especially I with the book in particular, the fact that her lightsabers are white, I don't know. I just think that's kind of speaks to her purity and her where she's at, and that she doesn't pick a side. She's kind of neutral. And obviously, like we talked about before, I'm really intrigued as far as, like, okay, where's this Gandalf the white thing going? Yeah, I want to know more. So she's definitely something... She, you know, there's a lot of meat there, and there's also mystery still left, and I think that's perfect in Star Wars, and I think she's a great character that's a non-film character that really kind of been fleshed out a lot in different avenues, so.
Yeah.
So there you go. That's our Imperial inspection of Ahsoka. And Heather, I'm so proud of you. You didn't mess up at all.
Thank you.
I have a sickness. Yeah. It's kind of like a Chicago thing. It's like, you're like, hey, Ahsoka over there looks great. You know, we were trooping and she was there and somebody was dressed up as Ahsoka from the Rebel Legion. And, she leans over to me. That's a great Ahsoka. I mean, I'm like, you mean Ahsoka?
Ah, that's cute. So,
It's all good. It's all good. We can't. I can't even say her species right, so it's all good. It's all good. It's
you know
all
what? Fine. And I can't all... say Gamorrean. So oh, that's I just did, but all good.
We all learn.
We all do.
Okay, Heather, why don't you take us into news of the week?
And now the Star Wars news of the week.
So, news of the week. We're going to start us off here at mirror.co.uk with the headline, Major Star Wars Plot Hole for Leia Organa and Padme Amidala has finally been fixed.
Tell me about this.
Added the word finally.
Yeah.
But let's see here what we have. The original Star Wars trilogy features a scene within Return of the Jedi, where siblings Luke and Leia discuss memories of their mother. Leia states that she remembers images and feelings of her very beautiful, kind but sad mother.
What do you remember?
Just images, really. Feelings.
Tell me.
She was very beautiful, kind, but sad.
So sweet. And then the prequel trilogy comes, and we learn about their mother, Queen and later Senator Padme Amidala. Everything seems to be going well. However, in Revenge of the Sith, Padme passes away shortly after giving birth to the twins. So how does Leia remember her mother?
How is that possible?
Oh,
tell me.
I have an idea, but I want to know.
Okay, so here's what the news says. A new comic in the Star Wars Adventures 2019 annual show has shown that Leia can indeed remember her mother. So, the strip within the comic shows a toddler Leia escape from her adopted mother, our, of course, beloved Queen Brea Organa.
Mm-hmm.
And so she runs away from her droids and stumbles across a statue of Queen Amidala. So, the Queen of Alderaan goes on to tell Leia about Padme. Before ending, she states, Leia, I know you're too young to understand all of this, and even to remember, but I want you to hold on to this image, this feeling, that spark, the spark, you have it too. Oh
my God.
And I know, right, Tia? So, according to that, that explains everything.
Right.
A statue and an explanation.
There you go.
Plot hole filled.
Filled. Spackle. Spackled it on. Michelle, what was your theory? What were you thinking?
It was
there?
Along that lines. I thought I remember seeing some sort of comic strip, though I think it was when Leia was older. She's looking at a mural of the queen, of Queen Amidala, and... She's like staring at it and she's like, why does this like seem familiar? And I guess she has a moment where like the portrait like looks back at her. It's kind of weird, but it's better obviously in as an image rather than me trying to explain it. But I was always guessing that, you know, there was a way that Leia could feel that she was somehow connected to the queen, obviously not knowing that the queen was Padme, or maybe she.
Right.
No, she would have then. Padme, yeah, she would have known that the queen was Padme if the toddler thing is true as well. So then you just combine those two things and yeah, there's another there's another way she knows, I guess.
There you go.
Yeah, so, exactly.
Todd?
Yes.
What are you thinking?
No, I think that's good. Okay. I'm okay with it.
You're good with it? All right.
Yeah, it's that's good spackle. I don't think that's a stretch because the way I always thought about it, even with the prequel trilogy and before this comic, is just that she felt it through the Force. So, and that's where she's kind of seeing these images. And just like when, you know, some of the things that you think about as a kid, you're like, I think I was there. And maybe the picture kind of triggers something in your head. Mm-hmm. And so you make this kind of up. And I always thought that's what Leia did in a sense. Like she found out about the Queen of Naboo and maybe there's some kind of connection and maybe Brea said something, but I don't, again, she doesn't know that she's adopted. I don't know. It didn't seem like that. you know, obviously in Return of the Jedi, but I always thought like she kind of put a picture and a memory together, and that's kind of how she's like images really when she's, you know, talks to Luke. So yeah.
All right.
All right. Next up, this is from Sci-Fi Wire. There's quite a few things in this article, but basically it says Star Wars Weekly, the Galaxy gets its first woman director in a Snoke comic ignites fandom. So first up, Bryce Dallas Howard is a famous actor. She can be seen in Jurassic World, a couple other things, I'm sure. I just can't think of them off the top of my head. But she's putting on the director's helmet for The Mandalorian. So she's directing. I think she at least directed one episode, but she spoke to IMDb about working on the show and her excitement and her film and the Star Wars guides in Jon Favreau and Dave Filoni, who are amazing. And so we're not going to play the clip here, but go check out IMDb's Twitter and you can see the little interview. But basically, her enthusiasm is shown in the clip, and we can't wait to see a woman director bring to what, you know, Star Wars has, because considering, honestly, it's been all male. So what do you guys think about this? Michelle.
I love that.
Yeah.
I think she's going to do a great job. I've liked her work in Jurassic World and other things, too. But yeah, long overdue, I think.
Yeah.
And obviously, she, like you were saying, she has wonderful mentors, Jon Favreau, Dave. I think that she'll just bring, you know, a fresh new perspective, given that she is a woman. And yeah. I don't know. I'm excited for it. Yeah, it's going to be great.
Heather, what say you?
Yeah. You know, anytime you have someone who's been in the industry and understands it, is part of anything that has a lot of fan force behind it, like the Jurassic stories, especially having the original Jurassics and kind of this little revamp again to take something that fans love, like the Star Wars universe, and then put a spin on it through The Mandalorian, I think is good. And I believe, is she not the daughter of Ron Howard? So directing has to be in her blood somewhere.
Yeah, well, and I would assume that she was on set for Solo. So
that, right? So there's that
probably connection. And honestly, that's probably where that connection happened. And they're like, you know, later, like, hey, you know, because a lot of there's different directors that are happening for Mandalorian. And I'm sure that's where they're like, let's get you here, you know. And Daddy probably put in a good word too. It was like, hey.
Right. You know? She's like, I have references.
Right,
you need to check
them. Right. My, I don't know if you know this, but my dad did Solo. You know? But I think it's good. JJ, I'm forgetting the lady's name, but she is the second like secondary director for Rise of
Something.
Yes,
Victoria something. I'm going to butcher her last name, so we'll just say
right, right, right. Yeah. Victoria something. But, you know, so this is really, you know, a thing where, you know, now we're getting a different perspective and helping on the secondary unit and, you know, which is great. But this is actually, you know, she's taking, you know, she's taking helm. Bryce is taking helm on an actual Mandalorian episode. So I'll be curious to see what it is and, you know, then kind of dissect and say, yeah, could we see something different? Or is it just like her take and, you know, what she likes? So I'm interested to see that. So speaking about Mandalorian real quick, this is a bonus one. Composer, here's a fun name, Ludwig Göransson. I think, oh man.
Göransson.
Where's Aaron? He's always good with these. he's composing the score with, and of course, Dave Filoni, no joke, drew up this Mandalorian sketch on some music sheet thing, and it's completely boss mode.
It's really great.
I just don't even understand. So, Ludwig posted this picture on his Twitter. And it's dope, so check that out. But yeah, the other thing is this, it's not Heather's rap career, but I don't know, maybe that's going to change in Cantina Chat. But
right.
if you're not aware, Marvel Comics released a one-shot. A one-shot is basically, that's it, one shot. Kind of like Han Solo and Greedo. I don't know. You could take it either way. But one shot is just a comic, and just one comic. No, you know, you have to read like six bazillion or buy 20 trades and put them all together. But this is Star Wars Age Resistance. Snoke, yes, came out last week. And it has fans talking. Takes his new apprentice, Kylo Ren, to none other than Dagobah. Holla. So, but because of the nature of Kylo's experience, lingering mysteries about Snoke and the significance about the cave, which we talked about a couple weeks ago with our good friends from Conversations, Pat and Charles, we talked about the cave. And now here's Kylo going in the cave. It kind of adds to mythos. The cave is very special. But it's kind of... the guy says here, personally, I think the issue needs to be viewed in the context of not only Luke's failure there in Empire Strikes Back, but with Anakin's vision of Mortis, Rey's experience in Mirror Cave. What does it tell us about Ben Solo? So if you want to read a little bit more about what happened at Dagobah, go get the Age of Resistance comic. So, Michelle, have you got this comic, or do you read comics? Or
I do read comics. I'm very behind, okay, though. I usually stick to the miniseries comics because if all of them are out, then I can just kind of rapid fire read them all in one sitting. And so if they're like in I think the Star Wars annual, what, had like 70 some issues or something. I don't know. There was a long running comic and I was like, I just can't keep up with it. So all of the Age of blank, 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 like Republic, Rebellion, and Resistance have been coming out. I just haven't gotten to them yet. But I did hear about the Snoke comic. I'm intrigued because I did think Snoke was very fascinating as a villain. So I hope that gives some more insight into him. And then I think seeing some insight into how Ben becomes Kylo Ren is interesting too. So
yeah. And I think Dagobah in that cave is like significant for all our heroes. And the fact that they basically made Snoke like evil Yoda in a sense to Kylo Ren, I think it's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Heather, do you have anything to add here?
Not really a comics kind of lady. So
me, no read.
What, reading? I don't know what that is.
Right.
So I do think the idea though of Dagobah is interesting with Ben. At this point, I'm just more interested in the fact that everyone that turns evil gets a new name. Like, what's up with that?
Oh my God.
I'm just saying. Why can't Anakin just be Anakin?
Because he needs a boss-sounding name.
Yeah, man.
Yeah. Got it.
Yeah.
I would guess. That's the reason.
Plus, he's got to hide his identity.
What was Snoke's name before it was Snoke?
I don't know.
No, he's just Bartholomew a one-namer.
Or something? Like, yeah. Snoke. He's like Prince and, you know.
He's like Yoda. Yoda's just Yoda.
Yoda. Yeah.
Yoda's just Yoda.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, exactly.
So, I don't know. But
yeah,
I'm all for more Snoke information because clearly we didn't get enough of it. So.
Right. Need more Snoke. Need more Snoke.
Nope.
All right, Heather, what wrap this up. What else we got here?
Do we have another one?
We have one more.
We do have another one, people. So, 94.7, thewave.radio.com from the soul of Southern California.
Okay.
Just want to give them all their props.
Right, exactly.
They go, Star Wars, Darth Vader helmet can be yours. For only $450,000.
Good God. What is that? Like an authentic prop or something? Oh my gosh.
I'm so glad you asked. Let's find out.
Yeah.
So if you've ever wanted to join the dark side, this is your chance.
Okay, I'm ready.
According to The Hollywood Reporter, you can now buy the famous Darth Vader mask and helmet. The pieces that were worn... by actor David Prowse during the filming of the 1980s film The Empire Strikes Back will soon be available for purchase.
Wow. Oh my gosh. So it is from Seth.
I know. Okay. So as of this recording.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You have 10 days.
Okay.
So happening September 25th and 26th.
Okay.
In Calabasas, California.
Mm-hmm.
Profiles in History will auction off more than 950 lots of entertainment memorabilia.
Wow.
Wow.
So things in, like, the Wizard of Oz items, those her famous dress, Luke Perry's Dylan McKay school ID from Beverly Hills 90210.
Gotta have that. Gotta have that in my collection.
I mean, if you're going to buy anything.
Yeah. Yeah.
Get a laminated piece of paper.
Right.
Okay. The glasses that Harry Potter wore during Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone.
Heather, you gotta get those.
Yeah.
I'm on it. Or of course, the Darth helmet.
For $450,000?
For a mere $450,000.
Well, but that's the thing.
Which is probably the starting bid.
I was going to say, that's the starting bid. That's not what it's going to actually cost.
Right.
Yeah.
So, should we all just pool our money together?
Let's do it. You know what?
No.
Wait, we got one yes and one no.
No, I'm saying no. I say, you know, that's like... Heather, can you back me up on this? Don't they have an R2 unit at Galaxy's Edge you can buy that's like $10,000 or something?
They do.
Oh my gosh. Yeah.
They do indeed.
So, but that doesn't even work. So here's the deal. You can build an R2 and you can get a Darth Vader costume for less than $450,000. So
True
story.
And then you can walk around and be Darth Vader and not have to worry about, like, I don't want to break this because this was worn by David Prowse and, right. You know, I
so
just,
if you want a Darth Vader helmet,
yeah,
you should join
the 501st. Hey. It's going to cost you less than, it's not going to cost you $450,000. So
that's true.
Yeah. It's a lot of money.
Well, if you guys aren't prepared to spend that much money.
Yeah, I'm not. No. There's no way.
Then I think what we need to do is move into a more reasonable fandom through Cantina Chat. See what I did there? Do you see the transitions? I'm winning.
Dude.
Winning.
Yeah, you're winning life.
Cantina Chat. This is our time for us to chat about all things nerdy, geeky, just what you had for lunch yesterday, whatever you got. So
a Ronto wrap, you know.
I mean, yeah. Options are endless.
Right.
Michelle, as our guest, we're going to have you start us off.
Okay.
What exciting things have been going on?
Well, so the Saturn Awards were yesterday as of recording this. One of the shows that either won an award or were talked about was The Twilight Zone, with Jordan Peele, or at least the new season of it. And I've always heard about it, but, you know, people would make references like, ooh, it's like The Twilight Zone. I'm like, what are you talking about? Because I just didn't know what it was referencing, because I just never watched the original show. So I started watching today, actually, the Jordan Peele's Twilight Zone. It's quite good. They're single, like, episodes, so you can watch. There's kind of like Black Mirror, I think, so you can watch them and not... Like, you could skip around or you don't have to see the previous show or even the previous episodes to understand the next one. So that's a nerdy thing I did, I guess.
Nice.
Awesome.
Very cool. So as we stated earlier, Aaron's off for the night.
He's probably RPGing or doing something nerdy with his Biff pacifist.
Sorry, I can't record tonight because I'm a...
Yeah, I have to talk like a Wisconsin Biff. Pacifist or something, but I'm sure he's having fun and geeking out, so we will hear about that next week. So Heather, how about you? What's going on? Are you fully recovered from your trip to Disney?
I'm gonna go with like 95%.
Yeah.
I was fortunate enough to get a sinus infection post trip.
Oh, post-trip.
Have heard occasional. Well, no, like mid to post trip.
I was gonna say you lost your voice. You like.
It was bad. Yeah, it was bad.
It was bad.
But I have just that little bit of, like, dry cough thing going on still, so...
Fantastic. Thank you, Disney.
Sorry, everybody. Right. Still totally worth it. I'm just saying. And then haven't unpacked everything yet. Yes, it's been, like, 2 weeks, people. Just let it go. I just have some souvenirs that I just have to find homes for, but...
These are tough adult decisions.
I was going to say, what a great problem to have. I love that.
But yeah, so it's been kind of just re-entry into the world this past week. You know, I had to work all 5 days.
Such a tough life, man.
Oh my gosh. There's that cough we just talked about. Right. And yeah, just sort of I introduced my droids to my cats.
How'd that go?
Well, my little Minerva, my little girl, was definitely more willing to get close until my little R unit's head circled. And then all of a sudden she's like, whoa.
Time out on the field. What's going on here? Yeah.
My big guy, Albus, watched from a safe distance because, you know, he's just skittish about everything. And then I had taken my BB unit out to do a little photo session.
Because that's what you do.
That's what a good droid mom does.
Yeah, right.
And because of the way the BB unit moves, with the head really moving around that whole sphere to then move the whole sphere forward the way it's designed... Oh, the kitties were not as okay with the BB unit. You can hear the mechanism a little bit more, so it's a little louder even. And so it wasn't until it was completely still that my little kitty finally kind of was like, are you safe to be around? So that was tons of fun, just to get to play with them a little bit that way. So
these are cat mom problems right here, man.
Listen, it's a hard life I lead, but so it's good. And I think I stated this last week, but I just have my Jawa boots to make, so my hope is to get those done this coming week. So I'm stating it now on this podcast. So when we record next week, my goal is to tell our adoring fans that my boots are done. So.
Yeah.
Fingers crossed, everyone.
Yeah, we got a troop. Come on.
May the force be with you. You got this.
Yeah.
So, yeah, and then hopefully next week I will tell you that I've submitted for 501st approval, and we will go hunt droids.
Yeah, then you could actually steal droids for fun.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. True story. But that's kind of about it, and apparently I'm going to go buy a book.
Yes. No. You're going to listen to a book.
Well, but I still have to buy the book.
Well, yeah, that's true.
You could do both.
That's true. Yeah, you could do both. Yeah.
Read along while you're listening.
Right. Yeah.
There's an idea. Yeah. There's an idea.
Yeah.
So, anyway, Todd.
Yes.
How the heck has your week been?
Oh, man. I leveled up this week. I am.
True story.
Leveled up to 44, man. It is. I'm double fours, so yeah, there you go. So always good to do that and stay around for an extra year, you know. So.
Happy belated birthday.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Yeah, so.
Did you get any fun things for your birthday?
My mom got me something from Disney, and I'm just waiting for it to come, and it's like this flannel. It's like a flannel with Imperial cog on the front pocket, and then it's like something on, like, it's got a stormtrooper thing on the back, and it's like destroy rebels or something. And I'm like, so yeah, I'm gonna be rocking that out. And I got some money, so I'm saving that money for Triple Force Friday.
Sweet.
I mean, it's coming very closely, guys, and so I have to be prepared for that. So, yeah, no, it's been fun, and I just finished Black Spire. So that's by Delilah Dawson, and we gave out two books to our listeners the last week, and I just finished the book, and it's pretty good. I really enjoyed it. Lot of fun stuff and really kind of fleshing out the world and all that kind of stuff. And it's good. And I'm staying on record. I really feel we're going to see Bud 2 in Rise of Skywalker. Just throwing it out there. Let everybody know. So I really, in December, I just want to say a big, I told you so. They put it on the map. They put it on the timeline. They said Galaxy's Edge is right here in between the movies.
I thought they said that it was going to be in the movie. Is that not actually confirmed?
I don't think they said that.
Damn. Okay, that's cool. I hope it happens.
Yeah. I mean, Chewbacca's hanging out there. The Falcon's there.
Right.
I don't know. That's just me. It's just me. But anyways, it's a really good book. There's Crash of the Fate, I think it's called, and this one are both about Black Spire and everything, and they really flesh out the world. And this one's really good. I would if you've read Phasma, two of the characters, Vi and Cardinal, are recurring characters of Black Spire. So if you like that book, and you would like this book. So, yeah, I would check it out. It's really good. It kind of expands the world and obviously develops, you know, the Black Spire Outpost a little bit better. So, yeah. So that's me. Nice. Yeah.
Sounds good. All right. Well, I think we did it. I think we finished up the episode 140. I don't even know how to count anymore, you guys.
It's some number.
That's a number. Yeah. Anyway, episode 140. It's in the books. So I am going to put a bow on top of it. Friends, thank you again for listening to another episode of WSTR Galactic Public Access. As always, check us out on our social media. We are WSTR Media, all lowercase, all one word. And we always want to hear from you. So please comment. You can tweet us. You can rate us on the Apple Podcast. If you have a lot to say, you can email us at mailbox@wstrmedia.com.
Right. Add that manifesto about Ahsoka Tano, right? Hey. Just drop it. Yeah. Or like some kind of fanfic. Just drop it in here, man. We'll read it. Yeah.
Yeah. If you want to hear your voice on our podcast, then you should call us 630-557-WSTR 630-557-9787. We have operators standing by.
Yeah, Heather's waiting for them. Yeah.
I'm just sitting here waiting. Right. And yeah, we'll get that going. Of course, check out our back catalog of episodes as well as all of the links and all the things at podcast.wstrmedia.com. Fall is coming, people.
It's true.
Temperatures are cooling down. You need a new hoodie. So you're going to go to store.wstrmedia.com and pick yourself up a hoodie.
There you go.
But say you're like, I live in California. It doesn't get that cold. Or we're in Florida where the humidity is stupid. Great. We have tank tops.
Right. Yeah, that's true. It's true.
I'm just saying we have you covered. Yeah. I just want you to put that up.
Right, that's good.
Michelle, it's been, like, super awesome to have you here.
It's been wonderful being on.
So, clearly, all of our fans now want to be fans of you. So, how do we find you on the social medias?
Sure. You can find me on Instagram. That's my main platform, at AhsokaXTano, all one phrase. And my podcast, Fulcrum's Broadcast, is available on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and pretty much anywhere else you can listen to podcasts.
Excellent. Whoa. Excellent.
It's like right in the name. Like, you didn't even shy away from it. You're like, Ahsoka X Tano. Like,
yeah. Yep. one day I'll tell the story behind that. It's a long one.
Oh, it is? Okay, yeah. Okay. Well, you know what? Maybe we just have to have you back on to tell us the story.
Oh, because
clearly,
yeah.
You know, yeah, clearly we did not have enough time with you to get through that. But it's there. It's like literally in the name. Right. So again, you're saying Fulcrum Broadcast is like 30 minutes of you. Mm-hmm. Tell us about the quiz. Tell us a little bit about it. Give us the elevator pitch right now. Here we go.
Okay. It is a Star Wars game show where I try to guess the topic that random page on Wikipedia gives me. So that's anything in the canon Star Wars universe. It could be a ship model number, a lightsaber part, a character I've never heard of, or an animal I have heard of.
Right. Or a clone trooper skirt that you just like, boom, nailed it.
Or freaking clone trooper armor part that I happen to guess right because I had a lucky day. So, no, but in all seriousness, I've had so much fun doing it. It's just a lot of me coming up with theories and me guessing things and me having fun with the lore of Star Wars. And then the second portion of the podcast is just me talking about news, kind of anything that's on my mind that's Star Wars related. So, yeah.
Excellent.
Makes sense. Yeah. So how many podcasts have you done so far?
I just released the seventh one this morning, I believe. Yeah. We're on our way.
You believe. That's one more
count.
Podcast.
Yeah. Well, because I don't name them by like episode seven. Like I just name them based off of what the topic is and what I'm talking about.
Sure.
So I actually don't know. Yep. I think seven, yeah.
That's awesome.
Excellent. Very good. Well, next week, episode 141, we won't stop and we can't stop, people, because we have another special guest. And that is Pete Fletzer. And he is from Around the Galaxy, which is at ATGcast podcast. So there's just more Star Wars to talk about.
There always is, yes.
New friends.
New friends, yes. And old friends, yeah.
So, and old friends. Yeah. Right. So, not by age, just by length of time.
Right. I'm glad you clarified that, you know.
Listen, I'm here for everyone. Yeah. So, that's what we have for you. We, of course, have to end our show the way we always do. If you know it, say it with us.
Now this is podcasting.
I was ready to say it like little Anakin. I was like, now this is podcasting. Like, I'm so ready.